the final talk by James Henry.
I had a really weird dream last night. I've been working remotely from Europe based on US hours, so my sleep cycle is completely out of whack. And I had a dream last night about this meetup and giving this talk. I'm talking about Angular elements, custom elements, and then Angular elements. I had a dream that I was kind of out of body watching myself. The audience was very much like this. And I kept saying Angular elephants instead of Angular elements. And nobody, not even me, said, James, you're saying elephants all the time. And so I had this, I woke up in like a cold sweat thinking, oh my God, there's a recording out there of me just repeatedly saying Angular elephants. I'm originally from London, as you might hear in my voice. So it's a good Sherlock Holmes pun. I'm gonna be talking about custom elements and specifically how they apply to Angular elements. So the utilities that the Angular team has provided us to use Angular components and then when they actually package them up for use with native browser features. So we'll start by just bringing everyone up to speed on custom elements and Angular elements. And then we're gonna look at an interesting use case with something that Angular elements provides to us, but I haven't really seen talked about all that much. It's not usually the focus of these talks, but it unlocks really powerful use cases. So we'll be digging into some gnarly code related to extending the CLI, and we'll be doing that last. So less interesting stuff. My name's James. I have a very keen interest in TypeScript. I'm a Microsoft MVP on the subject. I've contributed TypeScript to support to ESLint, Babel and Prettier. TypeScript team just merged ESLint as the linter for the TypeScript repo, so I'm quite proud of that. TypeScriptCourses.com if you want to listen to my voice talk about TypeScript. I have a free course on there, a paid course as well. And I rarely blog, but that would be the address if I ever do again. So custom elements. We know custom elements if we've ever come from the AngularJS world, for example. We're used to the concept of having superpowers behind any arbitrary tags in HTML that we want. They're effectively custom tag directives, but they're built into the browser. So we don't have to worry about frameworks and stuff like that. We can write them by hand if we want to. There's a custom element registry built into modern browsers, most of them anyway, and you can use this feature to define a tag name and give it an implementation, give it some behaviors where it can take in properties and it can produce events for the outside world to consume. So you can think about your own custom HTML as if it was a component tree like in an Angular or React or a Vue app. So the key method on the custom element registry, the instance of which you get in the browser, is the define method. So this takes a custom tag name and an implementation. So each implementation is a class and it extends from a base HTML element of some kind. You can actually extend from other HTML elements, like a paragraph. You could make your own custom version of a paragraph tag, for example. So that would be the rare case where you might actually need this third object here, the optional extends object. You can do some clever stuff with that. But I would say the common case is you're just creating a new, effectively div-like thing, some kind of container which has some markup and some capabilities inside of it. So ultimately, what you'd produce is something called your-tag-name, which you could drop into any application, or just a plain HTML page, and it would work. Angular elements, on the other hand, are something that the Angular team has provided us as a way to, instead of having to author this class by hand, and I've cut out quite a bit of complexity there. There's all kinds of callbacks and lifecycle events and things like that, which you have to relearn from a browser perspective. So the Angular team has provided us a way to think about that class implementation, but in a way that we're already familiar with. The things on the left that we already know, we don't have to relearn how to write them in a way that custom elements in the browser understand natively. So as Rob Warmold put on his slides, I quite liked it. Angular component on the inside, standards on the outside. So the browser does not care that Angular is somewhere lurking within the implementation details of this stuff. The Angular elements library that comes from the Angular team wraps everything up in a way that the browser can generically consume. Point number two, zones being optional, they kind of are, but it's very, it's not quite a first class use case just yet, I would say. So you can, if you've got small, very concise elements and you're kind of pursuing the widget use case, where you really want to use Angular to package something up which exists in isolation and is never going to be part of a wider app in an Angular sense, you can probably get away with manually calling change detection and stuff like that. I would say, even though they are optional, I would say most Angular elements do use zones still. And maybe this changes in the future with the capabilities that Ivy unlocks for us. But the great thing is, obviously, once you have that magical piece of HTML that you can drop in anywhere, anybody can use it. If they've never used Angular, it doesn't make any difference because the way they interact with the thing is standards-based. They assign properties and they register event listeners on that element. So they could use it in a React app, in a Vue app, or a vanilla JS app. So ultimately, that same example that we had before, where we're calling define on the custom registry that exists in the browser. So this is effectively a shorthand for window.customRegistry.define. So that same example where instead of rolling our own class implementation, we're going to bring in the create custom elements helper function from Angular elements, and we're going to pass it an Angular component. That is going to give us our implementation class back as a result of that. So the Angular elements library handles mapping all of those things together, and so we just write our normal Angular code. It does take an injector here as an object, as an argument that you can pass in an injector and something we won't cover in great detail in this talk as well, called a strategy factory. And the bit I've kind of missed out here, there are a few different approaches you could take to get that injector in the first place. Most of the examples you'll see will effectively be creating a new app module, a brand new ng module at the root of an application, and then you just platform bootstrap module that thing. And so it's very much like bootstrapping any other Angular app. You can do that, that does work. The downside, though, is each one of your elements is basically a full Angular app in every instance. So for some use cases, that works really well. But in other cases, for example, if you wanted to have multiple Angular elements on this page at the same time, you're suddenly shipping two full Angular apps or more on the page at the same time. So that's not ideal in some cases as well. And funnily enough, that is the exact case that we're going to cover today. So I'm actually running the app already here. I think it was on 8081, yeah. So let's go over to Brave. So this is the incredibly beautiful app that I made. So I'll launch the app again. So I have a placeholder, just an empty placeholder, which I'm then loading an element into. And I have two different elements on the page here, element A and element B. And all kinds of events are being logged. I color-coded the events in the console logs so you can see which one belongs to which. But ultimately, the markup that we've got here is an Angular Athens root, which is the equivalent of the thing you would generate with an Angular CLI. It's a root HTML element for our Angular app to grab and to basically create a component tree within. And then we just have these two other things called Angular Athens element A and Angular Athens element B. These are custom elements. So these aren't Angular components, even though you could, well, they kind of are as well, but they started life as custom elements that then had Angular components created inside of them. So you can see this reference to ng version here. Hopefully that zoomed in enough. So it does actually stamp, one nice way of knowing, is my setup working at all? It does actually stamp the version of the framework onto the thing, just like it does with normal Angular code that it recognizes. So what I've done here is I've given an example of an app which has Angular running on the page, but we want to use it piecemeal. We want to use a bit of Angular here and a bit of Angular there. So there might be multiple use cases for this in the world. I think there could be. For example, if you had some kind of generic news site or something where you have multiple teams and maybe you want to have React in one part of the page or Vue in another or something like that. But one really good use case for this is if you're upgrading from AngularJS to Angular, because now you have the ability to say on my AngularJS pages, I can have a bit of Angular here and a bit of Angular here, and I have a clearly defined contract for communicating from the outside world with arbitrary HTML. So we're not dealing with upgrading and downgrading and all that kind of stuff. We just have any markup that is being injected into the page. We have some JavaScript to load, and AngularJS can handle that just fine. It can communicate with these pieces, no problem. So that's the kind of use case I want you to bear in mind as I'm describing this. We have Angular on the page, and we have an empty element. That's a bad term to use. We have an empty node here in the DOM. There's no components being rendered in here. There's no markup in here. All this is doing is providing the Angular framework to us, and we'll look at that in a second. You don't need to understand exactly all these logs just yet, but this is the final effect of what we're building. Angular Athens is an app. This is an NX workspace, which you might recognize from Victor's talk. So I have a single app in here. And I called it Angular Athens. So there's nothing crazy special about this app. for the most part. So I've added some stuff to it. I've not taken anything away. I've not really hacked at anything, but I've added some stuff to it. So I have an app component. I have an app module in the same way that I normally would, but I've done some additional things to them. So one thing I've done is I've completely cleared out the HTML of my app components. There's no contents here. The reason is I only care about my Angular app, the thing that I'm just using as normal, to provide me with an injector, which I can then pass to each and every one of my elements which I load onto the page. So we'll cover that again in a second. My app component, there's nothing special about this. It has a relationship with the HTML, the SAS, but as I say, those things aren't actually doing anything. This is the thing which is going to be running in an element. It's not going to be running in the main Angular app. I'm injecting the router and just pushing it onto this router instances, and I'm doing that in each case. So two completely separate elements, I'm pushing the router in there. So then, if I come here and I run one of the previous commands that I've run, which doesn't exist, never mind, I'll do it manually. So if I look at, if I compare shared context router instances with 0 with 1, you can see they are the same thing. They're the exact same thing. So even though these are two native elements that exist on the page, I've been able to sneakily share an injector between them, and therefore if I were to use NGRX, they'd get the same store. They'd be able to reference, they use the same dispatcher therefore and trigger the actions and all the great stuff. So this allows you to operate as if it's a normal Angular app, but allows you to thrive in an environment where you can't use a full Angular app. So the AngularJS upgrade is the prime example of that. All these other things are kind of nice to have, so I don't have to cover all these things. I'm basically logging events as I create the things. How do you actually get these on the page in the first place is perhaps interesting. So what I did in this particular case, I would say this script loading and all that kind of stuff is probably the thing that's most dependent on your context, on your existing application. So in my case, I just decided to use the index.html and rewrite it a little bit. Here's my magic shared context I defined. I just did it in a script in the head. So that's where all my callbacks live. Got some basic styles to make this on the page. Here's my root components for the Angular app, which just gives me my shared injector. And here's the two otherwise meaningless tags that exist on the page. These receive their behavior after the fact. These only receive their behavior when I lazy load in the JavaScript that gets created for these element entry points. So when I build, I create a JavaScript file for this element A and a JavaScript file for this element B as part of my compilation. So all I've done here down the bottom is create some vanilla JS script loading. I'm just creating a script tag, pulling in element and then the letter, so element A or element B as the source of that, and then that's where you see all the logs coming through. So I'm loading in two element scripts. If I were to comment these out, or comment one of them out, for example, I can show you how I build the application. So I'm building and I'm passing a plugin for a tool called NGX Build Plus. So in the example Victor showed you, he was customizing an awful lot of things about the build process. So he used a particular custom builder to make that possible. If you only care about tweaking the Webpack config of the normal build, which is all I care about here, NGX Build Plus is a good option. So it's an NPM package you can install and wire up, and it allows you to just tweak the Webpack config ever so slightly. So once I built it, I'm just serving the index.html file to myself, and that's what I've been loading in the browser. So now I've commented out one of the script loading aspects of the page. So you can see it's only adding element B. It loaded it in 6 seconds. Element A here has not really been doing very much. So I think I accidentally put the color wrong there. So if I look at the DOM now, element A doesn't have an ng host LIKC1 or an ng version 8.2.6. This is just dead markup. This has no meaning to the browser, and it has no meaning to Angular, because this isn't in the Angular app. This is just a freestanding bit of markup. So it's only when you load in the JavaScript that you have the superpowers for your markup. So this gives you complete control. If you have a legacy AngularJS app that uses require.js to load AMD bundles, this is where you would load these elements. You would load, using an AMD module resolution, the code that powers an element within a view on the AngularJS. So that's how you would handle that. As you can see, within my rendered thing, I have ng content. So what gets rendered inside is very familiar to you, is just Angular code. down the bottom here, you can see this is where I injected my script. So I'm doing it imperatively using the DOM, but most of the time you'd have some kind of script loader you're already using for your apps. So there's an awful lot of stuff that I've been covering already. This ng zone, ng element strategy factory is by far the most set and forget. This just ensures that when you run the code, all of the events inside the element are running inside the right zone. So I'm logging the zone that I'm running in here. I'm running in a zone called Angular. So when Zone.js runs on the page, it creates a root zone, and then the Angular framework creates a child zone of the root zone called Angular. And if your code doesn't run in that Angular zone, your automatic change detection won't work. So that's an important property, and that code just ensures that always happens. So that's what this file does. And the final piece is just showing you the implementation of the Angular code. So I briefly looked at this when I injected the router in here. Here you can see this is where I'm logging the running inside a particular zone. So I just know that from the zone on the window, what the current zone is. Here I have a TXT input and some number event output. So as I mentioned, what you get back ultimately from all of this effort is a native DOM element you can pass around anywhere. So if I have a TXT property in here and I have my rendered app, if I go in here to the DOM, find the element which is running as a custom element, if I access this using $0, that will allow me to access the DOM node that I'm currently focused on in the elements panel in Chromium-based browsers. If I set the property, because as we now know, inputs in Angular components are like properties in custom elements, if I change this property TXT to something else, it will update immediately because we've got Angular change detection running. It will re-render the component tree inside of that custom element. And so we can, if we wanted to, interact with our Angular code via just imperative DOM, which in certain circumstances could be useful. So I could do the same thing with the events, and that's in fact what I do on page load. I'm registering an event listener for that number event. So we'll see this some number event will come through. And as you can see, we get an instance of the custom event because that's what I'm logging out here. And detail is set to 11. So what we'll find is in here, I'm emitting the event, emitting the payload 11. So that's ultimately, I've emitted it from my event emitter, my vanilla Angular code, my some number events. I've emitted 11. And ultimately, that's come back to me in the form of a native custom event in the DOM that I can interact with, just like a document register, like add event listener, click. I can interact with this in exactly the same way. So the way that this gets built, as you've seen, is a single compilation. I just said ng build, and I build the app. So the final clever piece is, it's an alternative. The reason I shook my head when Victor said James will show you this is an alternative approach, where I'm basically, I know I have to build my app, and I'm just sort of slotting the elements in as entry points to the single Webpack build which already exists. So in Victor's demo, he showed that sometimes it can be useful to do ng build A, ng build B, ng build C. In my case, I'm doing a little bit of work to try and make it so I only have to run ng build, and then I just produce all the right JavaScript files at the end. The way I'm powering that is through a builder called ngx build plus. So I install the library and specify it as a builder for my app in my AngularJSON. It supports all the same options as the normal browser builder from Angular, so the one you get out of the box. And the one difference is I can provide it with a path to a plugin file, which it's defined. So I just created a builders directory in here and a file called ngx build plus plugin. And it basically, you can export an object which allows you to tweak your Webpack config. So it's dead simple. All I'm doing is iterating over that directory, and I'm adding to the entry object in the Webpack config that the CLI has generated behind the scenes, I'm entering a reference for each one of these subdirectories in here. So element A will be in here, and the path will be to its TS file here. In my particular case, it's a critical change. This would not work without this change, but the actual change I have to maintain is tiny. So that's the great thing about the way the CLI team has designed this builder architecture. If I need to have a custom use case, I can, and 99% of it will be maintained by the Angular team and not by me, which is a really nice property because I'm lazy. So that gives you all the power to have a single ng build command, produce all the JavaScript assets you need, so we can have a look at those in dist. So here I'm producing both a down-leveled ES5 and an up-to-date ES2015 version of my bundles, and all the main polyfills, runtime styles, vendor of a standard Angular app. So the difference here is I don't need to care about multiple instances of Angular. I only have the one. So it's all taken care of for me. I believe people's brains are boiled enough. So that would be a good time to finish.